in-game bosses are one of the great ways to challenge the player's skills. So, I decided to add a boss fight to my game. But before I do that, there are things I need to fix. Last time, I improved some of the visual effects to my parkour mechanics. Well, guess what? What you've seen in my videos is not entirely true. That shouldn't happen. And this also shouldn't happen. Kicking off between the walls had weird animations, climbing was still inconsistent, and balancing on a narrow platform sometimes didn't work. Point is, lots of bugs, no fixes. I mean, to be fair, bugs are all featured. Well, as for the wall run camera animation bug, that was easy to fix. Step 1. Revert the camera animation to the old one. Wait, don't do the beep transition as if I'm going to do something else, because this is actually what I did. You see, the new animation looked clunky, and for a smooth parkour experience, it just didn't fit very well. I don't know, man, sometimes things just need to be kept simple. The real bug was with vault motion. To understand the bug, here's how the vault system works in my game, in under 15 seconds. As soon as the player performs a vault, it finds a point where the player will move to. It then teleports the player to this point. But here's the thing, the camera isn't going to move with the player. Instead, it will stay at its last position and slowly and smoothly move to a new position. Sounds okay up until this point, but we need to remember that the camera's position constantly needs to be updated to the player's head position. So I'm performing a calculation to figure out a directional vector towards the original position. This vector will be applied as an offset to the player's head position. How can this be a problem? Well, take a look at this pseudocode. And here's my camera controller code. What's important here is that I'm setting the player's position via its rigid body's position, while I'm getting the player's position in the camera controller script via transform.position. Strangely enough, when you set a game object's position via rigid body, this is going to use the physics engine. In other words, when you're fetching position information, transform.position will not return the same value as rigidbody.position immediately when it's changed. Now back to my situation. There's a small gap before the rigid body's position gets updated. So essentially, the camera's offset gets applied first before the rigid body has actually moved. The solution to this problem is quite simple, however. All I had to do was get the player's position using rigidbody.position instead of via the transform component. Now everything is being handled by the physics engine. Furthermore, in case you're interested, here are some different ways to teleport a rigid body game object. There's something odd about the visuals. This is especially noticeable when the player moves into an indoor environment. Take a look at this. Do you see it? Well, take a look at it again. It might not be very obvious, but you'll notice how the arm isn't affected by the lighting surrounding the player. It's one of the things that as soon as you notice it, you can't stop thinking about it. Before I go on, I think it's a good time that I address how lighting works in Unity. By default, lights in Unity are real-time. In other words, the lights in the scene will be updated every frame. These lights only contribute direct light. That said, modern game lighting makes extensive use of a lighting technique called global illumination. In a nutshell, global illumination calculates how the light bounces off and interacts with the scene. This will result in a more realistic lighting setup. In Unity, there are mainly two ways to handle global illumination. Either baked global illumination or pre-computed real-time global illumination using Enlighten. When you bake a light map, this will essentially create a texture with shadow and light information captured. This texture can then be applied on top of scene geometry to accurately display lighting in a scene. This process is done in the Unity editor. In other words, you can't make any changes to the lighting in real time. In contrast, with real-time global illumination, you can update the scene's lighting real-time and the bounced lights will respond accordingly. Generally, I try to stay away from using real-time global illumination because of how computationally expensive this method is. Besides, this technique is mostly used in games with a time of day system. This scene in Project Terminal uses baked lighting. When moving a non-static game object around, it won't be affected by the baked, emissive materials. In my case, the first-person arms. The good news is that there is a way to get around this, and it is to use light probes. Light probes basically store baked lighting information at its position. So whenever a non-static game object reaches toward light probes will provide lighting to the moving game object. This is how the game looks now. When comparing side by side, the difference is quite substantial. Now for the boss fight. This is going to be a great way to end the first level of my game. Here's the starting position. The player will be first introduced with different parkour mechanics, and on the second floor, the player will encounter a first enemy. After crossing a bridge, the player gets to know the grappling hook and gets to freely swing around in this building. Once the player makes it to the end, the player climbs up and sees this. We have a big tower. The goal here is to get to the top of this tower, although it's not as easy as it was in previous scenes. There will be various distractions. For example, this explosive knockback attack. By the way, this attack is created using Unity's visual effect graph. Speaking of which, visual effect graph simulates particle behavior on the GPU, which allows it to simulate many more particles than the built-in particle system. Not only that, this effect is created using Unity's shader graph. There's a property I can change to control the behavior. Aside from that, there are also a bunch of turrets around the map that will constantly attack the player, knocking them away. And that's about it for the distractions so far. There will be more boss attacks added to the game soon, of course. Oh, and the boss has different phases. As the boss fight goes on, the boss will enter different phases, making the boss fight progressively more difficult. The system is already implemented in the game, but it's that I just gotta make more boss attacks. Let's have a look at the map. The map is designed in a way that the player has different ways to go to the very top. This way, they can decide on the most optimal path for them depending on the situation they find themselves in. The player might even be completely knocked off from the building too. In this case, they still have an option to climb up. Whoa, what is that? Oh, that's nothing much. It's just another small parkour mechanic I've made for the game. You see, while a grappling hook is a good way to swing around freely and travel from one place to another, it isn't very good to climb up. I mean, there is a climbing parkour mechanic in the game already, but I feel like there has to be something that's more powerful. So here's my idea. I'm making something called elastic rope. Essentially, this rope will act like a rubber band. When the player pulls down this rope, the rope will stretch, and quickly after, the player will be shot upwards. One small problem. Rope physics. Rope physics is one of those things that you think it's quite easy to make, but in reality, it's hard to make it look realistic. The simplest way to make decent rope physics in Unity would be to connect multiple rigid bodies together using a hinge joint. Except, it's hard to get it perfect, and for my purpose, it was overkill. And then I remembered watching this series of videos, which shows really nice and simple ways of handling ropes and wires, so let's give it a try. Except, I found this video through Sebastian League. He also briefly explained how it works. Basically, the points of a rope will continue to have the same motion based on their previous positions. These points are also constrained, as they are all connected together with a set length. The rope simulation looked surprisingly good, only to find out there was another problem. Collisions. I wanted to make it so the player could collide with the rope to push around. A solution I came up was to make a huge box collider that is connected from one end to another. As soon as the player collides with this collider, a force is applied to the points that are near the collision point. As for the actual elastic rope mechanic, all I had to do was attach one of the rope points to the player's hand position when the player presses a button while being close to a rope. This rope point will then be continuously locked and follow the player's hand position. I didn't have to separately animate the rope while players going up, as that's all being handled by rope physics. The hand animation looks slightly inaccurate, though. Still, I'm glad it turned out just as good as I had in mind before. Combining elastic rope with grappling hook mechanics, I can even do this. Anyways, that's it for my 6th devlog of my game, Project Terminal. I am aware that I said I'll work on the combat mechanics in my last 2 devlogs, but honestly, I'm not sure why I haven't been working on combat. I do have a decent idea for combat though. Hopefully that will be showcased in my next devlog video.
This has been Late Coder. I kind of delay my videos.